I'm canceling your entire debt. You owe me nothing. Not only does he go beyond just delaying the payment, he cancels the entire debt. Can you imagine such a thing? Can you believe if you were owed $3 trillion, you would say, oh, just forget it? You don't owe anything anymore? What do you do in return when you are relieved of that kind of burden? How can your life ever show the kind of gratitude that that would engender in you? Well, if you are the servant in our story for today, you go out and find a buddy and say, remember that $100 you owe me? Well, pay up or I'm going to see that you go to jail. We're just disbelieving that a man who's forgiven such an enormous debt could go out and then hold something against someone else that is of such minor importance compared to what he's just been forgiven. But maybe we shouldn't be that surprised at that kind of reaction. After all, the servant was within his rights when he demanded payment. He was owed a debt. He did have some rights to say, you owe me. But that's where forgiveness comes into the picture. One theologian puts it, you know, forgiveness is not so much about forgetting as it is about not insisting on your rights. When we say, I know my rights, we are calling attention to the fact that we have been hurt or injured. I've been hurt. I want justice. I want punishment. Forgiveness, though, instead says, I've been hurt. There's no doubt about that. I have been hurt. But instead of punishment, it is more important to me that our relationship be healed rather than you be punished. And that is hard and painful and beyond us. When we want to hold people to this strict accounting, treating them only on the basis of what we think they owe us, while forgetting that we ourselves have received this unmerited grace and that God has entirely canceled our debts to him, then we are just like that ungrateful servant, just as thankless as he is. Is that the kind of theological world you want to live in? You know, the end of the parable is kind of a harsh ending. When the master finds out that the servant hasn't responded in kind to the kind of mercy he's shown, then he says, okay, you want it to be an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth kind of world? All right, it'll be that way. And now you're going to be tortured and punished until you can pay up. Is that the kind of world you want? Or do you want a kind of world that you understand that you have been forgiven and the only debt that you have is to forgive others? I think we either forget or don't realize that our own capacity to forgive the sins of others depends directly upon how much faith we have in God's forgiveness of our sins. If we don't have basic understanding of forgiven, then we aren't going to be very forgiving. In those rare moments when we can discern our own sinfulness, own up to it, we realize that the forgiven forgiving servant is not just some wretch. He is you and I. We over the last month. And think about the times when you have said a sharp word to a spouse or a parent or a child or a co-worker or a neighbor. Something you wish you could take back. Think about something that you did that you wish no one else would know about. Time maybe when you behaved in a totally selfish manner. Think about a time when maybe you laughed at someone else's embarrassment or pain. And after you've done that kind of monthly self-evaluation inventory, then multiply that by 12. For things that you might have done in the past year that you would hope to be forgiven for. And then multiply that by however many years you've been on this planet. And to get an idea of what Jesus meant by forgiving this unmerciful servant such an enormous and unmanageable. And still, even knowing that, forgiveness is hard and painful and beyond us. We know, though, that even as much as we need forgiveness, we need help to be able to forgive others. God's help. We know our rights. But do we know the power of forgiveness? Forgiveness is difficult because the hurt can be so deep. When we discern our own sinfulness, though, and how much we have been forgiven by God, and how much God helps us to forgive others, then we are one step farther down the road in understanding and discovering what God's love is all about. Amen. Our hymn is number 515 as we prepare for communion. I will sing just the first verses of I Come With Joy. I will sing the last two verses at the conclusion of our communion service. For those watching at home on Facebook, I would invite you at this time to gather some juice or water or something to drink and bread and crackers so that you can participate in communion with us this morning. So those who are able, please stand as we sing, I Come With Joy. Please keep Margaret and Mike and their family in your prayers. And then we do have a joy to share this morning. I got a little nudge from someone letting me know that today's Marie Scovel's birthday, so happy prayers this morning. And as usual, during our offering time, we'll just take the time to remember how we might give of ourselves to others. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus said, "Freely you have received, so freely give." Think about ways in which you may freely give. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty Father, Creator and Sustainer of life, your majesty and power, your continued blessings, and your great goodness fill us with wonder. We are unworthy of the pardon you have in mercy given. We can bring only our thanks. Putting our trust in your Son, who alone saves us from evil. Therefore, in joy with the prophets, apostles, martyrs, and saints of every time and place, we join in giving you praise. God of glory, and thanks, we remember how Jesus broke bread and gave the cup to make us partakers of his body and blood, so that he might live in us and we in him. God of mercy, and thanks, we remember how Jesus invites us to his table, impressing our hearts his sacrifice on the cross. In gratitude, we bow before the righteous one, declaring his resurrection and glory, and knowing that his prayers alone make us worthy to partake of his spiritual meal. Almighty God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that as we receive bread and wine, we pray especially this morning for friends of Bud, for Charlotte, Bill, and Lori, Savannah, Marilyn, Joan, Dennis, Leslie and Patrick, Cindy, Bev, Mary Ann, John, Scott, John, Margaret and Mike. And for other members of our church family, especially today for Chuck and Tanner. Eternal Father, lift our hearts and minds on high, where with Christ your only Son and with the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours now and forevermore. It is in the name of Jesus who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive night of his arrest, took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to his disciples. I'm ministering in his name now and give it to you, saying, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the body of Christ given for you. In the same way, Jesus took the cup and he had given thanks. He gave it to his disciples, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. All of you drink of it. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Closing in today, the last verses of number 515, I come with joy. Blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you always.